everyone. I welcome you to our first parallel session this afternoon on climate change and public attitudes. And my name is Ina Meyer. I'm a senior economist at the Austrian Institute of Economic Research. My research focus is on climate mitigation and adaptation, and I will be your timekeeper for today. In total, we will have three presentations followed after one another, and for each presentation, we have a time slot of 20 minutes. Then the presentations will be followed by a discussant for about 15 minutes, and at the end, we will have time for questions and answers. So let's start right away with our first presentation. Are climate policies politically costly? With Michael Ganselmeier, please. The floor is yours.
Perfect. So thank you very much for the invitation, and we are very excited to present our paper today. Let me share my screen first. Perfect. Can you all see my slides? Perfect.
Okay. Yes.
One second. Oh. Sorry. Here we go. A few. Here we go. Can you see my slides? Now I'm in full screen. Perfect. So thank you very much for having us today. This is a paper that actually started quite exactly 1 year ago. And we asked a question, and was already raised a couple of times throughout the keynote today. And the question is, are climate change policies politically costly? And there are different motivations why we did the study. So before the pandemic, I think we all remember quite well that climate change policies was very, very widely discussed in many countries throughout the world, especially with the start of the Fridays for Future movement. We have seen that this green agenda setting in national parliaments, in national news media, got a lot of attention. And so also beyond this agenda setting aspects, we also see that there are other factors that actually should make climate change policies, in fact, politically more attractive to do. On the one hand, we know from the economics of climate change that the costs of not adopting the necessary measures will be very damaging in the long run, as we have heard in the keynote today. On the other hand, green parties rose substantially in the parliaments in the last 20 to 30 years throughout European and also other OECD countries. And at the same time, we see that certain NGOs, certain movements gain a lot of attention, which all promote more climate change policies. At the same time, what we consider as the interesting puzzle is, why do governments then not react if there are such important push factors for these policies? And with the present analysis, we want to answer this question with an empirical analysis, and we contribute in different ways. And one way is that we try to do apply a convincing causal identification strategy that is so far missing in the literature. So overall, we ask one big question: are climate change policies politically costly? And if they are politically costly, what can we do about them? So how can we design them in a way that make them easier and less costly for governments to adopt? And here we ask for sub questions. The first is, which kind of climate change policies are costly? So does it matter which instruments you use as a government? The second is, can social protection reduce the political costs? And what is the role of inequality consideration when you adopt these policies? The third one is, does it matter? So are certain countries Is it easier for certain countries to adopt such policies than for others? For instance, does it matter which industrial structure a country has? And fourth, what about the timing of the policies? There is some evidence that it might be good to time them depending on the level of the energy prices, and retest whether this is indeed the case. I want to give the key findings straight at the very beginning. So we find that climate change policies are indeed politically costly, but they don't have to be. What is important is that the policy design matters. Our empirical analysis shows that market-based policies are such as taxation on emissions. They have salient negative effects on the popular support of the government. However, we do not find these negative effects when we use non-market-based measures such as emission limits. Second, the effects are muted when climate change policies are adopted when inequality is low or when the welfare state is large enough to mitigate the political costs of climate change policies. Fourth, the effects are muted in countries where the industry of the economy depends heavily on dirty energy resources. And finally, the political costs are not significant when these policies are implemented during periods of low oil prices. And I will now discuss more in detail how we embed this in the literature. It was already outlined a couple of times in the keynote that climate change is on the one hand an economic problem, a technological problem, but a very important aspect is that it is a political problem. And the reason why it is politically so difficult to do is because these policies tend to create winners and losers. And this logic of the theoretical considerations are actually quite similar to the literature on the political economy of structural reforms. Just to be more specific, climate change policies are usually designed in a way that there are a few stakeholders which carry a large part of the costs while the gains are distributed across the entire population. The reason for this is that the nature or the environment is in itself a very good example for a public good. And therefore we have this gain dispersion while the costs, when you regulate emission, then these costs tend to be concentrated. And therefore, climate change policies have this tendency that they are regressive in nature because the elementary products get more expensive. So basically, there are not if you increase the taxation for oil, there are no the poor basically have to deal with these tax increases, and this constrains the budget constraints even further. A second consideration is that climate change policy hits certain industry intensively with a labor force that is harder to match with new job opportunities. There is some descriptive evidence by the OECD, which did a quite nice analysis about what are the descriptive characteristics of the labor force in danger. And therefore, it is important to consider which people tend to lose their job. And also, a very important aspect is the international political economy literature, which have long been arguing for this race to the bottom dynamics. It is also worth mentioning that the empirics is not so clear on this question, but in general, these race to the bottom dynamics can be quite substantial when it comes to climate change policies. And finally, also related to this aspect is are the spatial distributions of the costs and the timing of it. As it is now, the case is that the high polluting countries do not face the climate change consequences immediately, while others experience them more in the short run. And this is also what makes it quite complicated and from an incentive structure, how to incentivize national governments to act. So far about the theoretical considerations that we took into account. Now we want to, what we do in our study is we try to apply a macro level analysis by linking, by estimating the effect of climate change policies on the popular support of the government. And we do this by using a panel data set consisting of 31 OECD and BRICS countries from 2001 until 2015. Our dependent variable of interest is it's an index for popular support for the government that we use from the ICRG dataset, which ranges from 0 being the lowest support to 4 being the highest support. The popular support measure is constructed by country experts that use credible polling data about the government in office. This is the dependent variable. Then our main independent variable of interest are changes in climate change regulation. And here we use the environmental policy stringency indicators from the OECD, which covers a broad range of countries over a long period of time. And the index ranges from 0, not stringent at all, to 6, which indicates very stringent. We also control for a couple of important control variables. And we also use mediating factors in order to answer the single sub questions that I have outlined earlier. When it comes to our empirical approach, we start with a simple baseline model that exploits the panel data structure in our sample. Our main independent variable of interest is the changes in EPS, so changes in environmental policy stringency. The dependent variable is the measure for popular support for the government. And then we control for X, which is a vector of control variables. What we also do is in order to capture and take into account unobserved country-specific characteristics and unobserved period characteristics, we include country and year fixed effect. When it comes to analyze the mediating factor, which are, for instance, fuel prices, income shares, the Gini coefficient, we estimate this equation, where we do a set transformation of the mediating factor, which is here, F set, and then interacted with the changes in EPS. And then I also want to directly jump into our baseline results. Our baseline results show what I've already outlined earlier, that indeed the climate change policies change. So if you make as a government the environmental policy stringency higher, then this government has to suffer political support. And what we see here is first that the effect is highly significant. Second, that it is quite robust in terms of which model, which covariates we include on the right hand side. And in all estimations, we include both country and time fixed effects. Our first results, as I've already outlined, is that the instrument that you use as a government is quite important. And what our results show is actually that only market-based climate change policies are politically costly. For especially taxes or taxes on CO2 and so on. So we have all these different subcomponents in our indicators, but we do not find these politically costs when we look at non-market-based measures, such as this is the aggregated index. And then, for instance, here we have limits on NOx, PM, or MSO. So here we don't have any significant effects on the political support variable. Again, we use the baseline specification from the first table I've shown you. In a second step, we analyze if there are any tools, how we can mitigate these political costs. And indeed, what our interaction models show is that timing and country heterogeneity matters quite a lot. For instance, if a government adopts climate change policies when the oil price is high, the political costs are quite substantial and significant. when the oil price is low, we do not find a significant effect. The same is true for the gas prices. And also what we show is that the countries that depend heavily on dirty energy share as an input in the production, there the climate change policies are politically more costly, while we do not find significant effects when the dirty energy share is low. Then probably one of the most interesting findings in our view is the inequality considerations. So we do find that when the top income share is high, the political costs are higher, but if it is low, we do not find effects. And these findings hold for different specifications of the percentile we are looking at. So if it is the 1, 10 or 20% of the income distribution. On the other side, so basically the mirror of it, we also find evidence if the bottom 20% is low, political costs are higher, while if it is the bottom 20% share is high, then we do not find significant effects. We do not find the results though for the bottom 1%. Here we also report a more aggregated inequality measure by using the market-based Gini. Again, if the Gini coefficient is high, the political costs are high. If it is low, then we do not find the effects. So taken together, these inequality results, we also try to analyze what is the effect of the welfare state and of social expenditure. And what we actually can see is if these climate change policies are adopted by governments that already have a enough or high social expenditure as percentage of GDP in place, we do not find significant effect. However, if we do not have enough social insurance, then these political costs are substantial and highly significant. Here we look at subcomponents of social expenditure, for instance, unemployment insurance, which again speaks to the results of the aggregated picture. And ALMP is active labor market policies. So basically, if a government provides enough training opportunities for the ones who might lose their job, then this can actually mitigate the political costs. And so these are our baseline results. I quickly also want to now discuss our identification strategy, as the OLS estimates might suffer from endogeneity concerns. So I think three endogeneity concerns are particularly important. The first is measurement error. Measurement error is a particular problem if we have attenuation bias, when the measurement error is correlated with the error term, because this will bias our estimates. The second one is omitted variable bias. So even though we control for the country and we have fixed effect and other economic, political, and demographic covariates, we cannot say with certainty that we have control for all important aspects. And this is why we have, it might be possible that our OLS coefficients are either upward biased or downward biased. And in order to address these issues, we adopt an instrumental variable approach that is a bit inspired from the shift share IV literature that uses a global time varying indicator that describes climate change pressure. Here we use the measures of global extreme weather events, for instance, the number of people affected by natural disasters throughout the world in a given year. And we use a country specific constant that is a geographical indicator that should capture the vulnerability that a country has towards climate change. So for instance, here we use the length of the coast or the average distance to a coastal area. And these indicators basically should capture how vulnerable is a country. Taken together, these two factors, we interact them in order to create the instrument. And then our instrument follows a standard instrumental variable, 2SLS setup, where we include both country and year fixed effects. Set is the interaction of these two factors. And here we instrument then the change in EPS in the first stage, and then in the second stage, we can estimate the causal effect. Again, overall, our results are broadly consistent with our baseline. The only difference is that we tend to underestimate the effect in the baseline. What we see here is that in our IV results, we have the coefficient is actually up to 3 times as large as in the OLS baseline. To provide several robustness checks, we use different kinds of instruments. So for instance, here we use as global term, the events of flood interacted with the coastal length. Here we use the number of hurricanes interacted with the distant minimum distance from the center to the next coast, and so on. And what we see is that overall our F-stats are sufficiently strong, all above 11 or 10, and the coefficients are significant throughout specification. So the most important identifying assumption for our instrument is the exclusion restriction. And what we try to do is, after all, we can never fully attest if this exclusion restriction is really given, but we try to provide a couple of tests. The first test is that what happens if we include the instruments in itself as an additional control in the baseline OLS model. And what we want to see is, hope to see is that there is no significant effect. And this gives us confidence in the fact that there is no direct channel of our instrument on the political support variable. The second test we are providing is we add additional control variables. I think I'm running a bit out of time, therefore I go a bit faster now. And again, these results support our confidence that we have that the exclusion restriction is sufficiently fulfilled. Very briefly, in conclusion, our IV estimates broadly back up our OLS estimates. This is true for the inequality results, both on the top and on the bottom of the income distribution. For the aggregate measures of the Gini coefficient, both Markey and the net Gini, and also for the social expenditure variables. So let me briefly summarize what our paper has tried to do. First, our paper has shown that climate change policies when using macroeconomic data, we find that the climate change policy can indeed be politically costly, and these effects can be substantial and significant throughout specification. However, policy design matters, and there are ways that governments can adopt these policies without fearing the political backlash. The first result is that market-based climate change policies have salient negative effects on popular supports. Here, one result can be that non-market-based measures can be very suitable tools to achieve certain emission reduction, but at the same time do not create this political backlash. The effects are muted when climate change policies are adopted when inequality is low, as well as higher social expenditures seem to effectively mitigate the political costs. What does this mean overall? The welfare state and social expenditure is very important to compensate the losers and the most vulnerable to these climate change policy, especially in the short run. Third, we have found that the countries where the non-green dirty energy share is relatively large, these governments have to fear larger political costs. Therefore, it is important to take the country specificities into account and also coordinate this accordingly at the international level. And finally, the political costs are not significant when climate change policies are implemented during periods of low oil or gasoline prices. I think we can all say that at the moment, this is a good timing to adopt these policies. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Michael, for this interesting presentation and highly policy relevant research results. And yes, as we skip our discussion to the end of the session, we jump directly to the next presentation on climate change awareness, empirical evidence for the European Union, and Claudio Morana, the floor is yours, please.
Thank you very much. And thank you very much for the indeed for the opportunity of presenting this work, which is joint with Donatella Baiardi. So in this paper, we are interested in understanding the drivers of climate change concern in the European Union. And we are starting from some descriptive evidence published in the Special Eurobarometer on Climate Change Survey 2019. Evidence shows that climate change is increasingly seen as one of the major threats to the world as a whole by EU citizens. About 60% of respondents retain climate change as one of the first four major challenges, and about 20% of them rank it as the most important challenge. Moreover, about 80% of respondents retain it as a very serious threat. Still, there is quite a large heterogeneity across European states, as you can conclude by looking at this heat map, which refers to year 2019 and refers to our favorite proxy for climate change concern. This proxy is constructed to yield an estimate of the percentage of respondents who rank the climate change as one of the four most important challenges and at least of serious gravity. And clearly you can see from this map that climate change concern is highest in Northern European countries, is actually lowest for Eastern European countries, and concerning Western and Southern European countries, you see that these countries are in between. So a key question then here concerns what are the drivers of these heterogeneity. And understanding these drivers then indeed the objective of this paper, which appeared to us a very urgent task, as in democratic systems, legitimacy of political decision on climate change mitigation action do rely on support of public opinion. And we can expect that public opinion will be in favor of implementation of climate change mitigation action only when there is a sufficient understanding and concern for the economic, human, social, and political implication of climate change. And moreover, in light of the Paris Agreement carbon budget, there is a urgent need for the implementation of these climate change mitigation actions. So in this paper, we then focus on the evolution in climate change concern in Europe over the last decade. This period is obviously very interesting as it allows to assess how climate change attitudes in Europe have responded to some very important events, such as the introduction of the Paris Agreement and then the election of former US President Donald Trump, who has unfailing acted against the Paris Agreement and also response to the environmentalists' response to these denial campaigns, which has been led by Greta Thunberg and her Fridays for Future movement. And at our knowledge, there are no studies in the literature which have been focusing on data more recent than 2014. Moreover, our analysis is based on data taken from the Special Eurobarometer Service on Climate Change, which are the surely the most suited data for to carry out the analysis we accomplished. And surprisingly, this data have been so far neglected in the literature. And finally, we focus on aggregate survey data behavior. And this is also something different from previous literature. And I'd like here to show you some descriptive evidence again. These are statistics for the cross-sectional distribution of climate change concern for EU27 plus the UK for the period 2009 through 2019. These survey data are biannual data. And here I'm reporting figures for our favorite proxy for climate change concern, the one that I already show you concerning year 2019 in terms of the heat map. So again, I repeat, this proxy is an estimate for the proportion of respondents that rank climate change as one of the four most important challenges and retain it with a threat of at least serious gravity. So in terms of central tendency of the distribution, you can see that there is little change up to 2017. There you can find a sizable drop. And then in 2019, you can see an even more sizable increase in then climate change concern. Then obviously the first question relates to what is indeed the key driver of this such a dramatic change in climate change attitudes. And previous literature on the effects of leadership cues on public polarization obviously provides some insights pointing to indeed the potential role of two very different leaders, say a brown leader. I refer to former US President Donald Trump, and a green leader, and here I'm referring to Greta Thunberg. And indeed, you can associate this switch to key events that are related to the actions of these two leaders occurring in 2017 and 2019. But just to remind that former US President Donald Trump acted unfailingly against the Paris Agreement since his presidential campaign, till the point of announcing the withdrawal of the US from the Paris Agreement that was formalized then in 2017. And concerning concerning Greta Thunberg, she achieved something that is really remarkable as starting from a solo movement in September 2018, she was able to mobilize about 4 million people across 169 countries just within 1 year. Obviously, this analysis is unconditional and is unable to establish a causality linkage between climate change concern and political leadership, or to pin down a driver of additional drivers of climate change attitude. For this, we need a conditional assessment. Still, this descriptive evidence is suggestive of some non-linearities in the evolution of climate change attitudes and the potential role of political leaders. So this leads us to consider setting our conditional analysis within the setting of the model of information diffusion This model then predicts that in innovation, when the decision to adopt is voluntary, then spreads across the members of a social system according to an S-shaped curve. So then here you find the basic equation in our model, where YT here is our measure for climate change concern, and the vector XT here is the vector containing information on our on variables that can account for the determination of climate change concern. Now, in terms of variables, we surely posit a key role for standard of living as measured by real per capita GDP. This is obviously following for the public good nature of environmental protection, that then we to assume a positive relationship between real per capita GDP and climate change concern. Your intuition is that as a society become more affluent, we also start to value more post-materialistic values, and such as the quality of life and quality of the environment as well. And there is also an obvious link with the environmental goodness curve, as we can expect that as economic growth and development progresses, it also became sustainable, and therefore we could expect then an inverse relationship between per capita greenhouse gases emission and the per capita GDP. We suggest to name this positive non-linear relationship between climate change concern and per capita GDP, the climate change awareness curve. And here again is just some descriptive evidence supportive of this potential existence of this S-shaped behavior concerning the EU 27 plus UK data over this the specific range of values for per capita GDP. Here you have on the horizontal axis per capita GDP, and the vertical axis our proxy for climate change concern. And again, looking at focus on this range of values for per capita GDP, and then considering their association with per capita greenhouse gases emission, we find some confirmation that this climate change awareness curve is exists when the environmental Kuznets curve is on its downward sloped portion. Now, in addition to real per capita GDP, we are going to consider a lot of potential determinants. Obviously, the role of political leaders, green and brown, in terms of inputs, dummy variables, then a set of variables related to the greenness of the cultural environment. And you have to find the list, and you see in both. Okay, so it seems that there has been an interruption concerning the audio. I will then start from, I think the audio was stopped. Here you find in bold the variables that have been found and statistically significant in at least some of the regressions that we have been considering. So relative power of right-wing parties, the share of young people or total population, trust in institution, and per capita greenhouse gases emission. Then other variables which refer to acquisition and processing ability of theoretical information about climate change. They are measured by the secondary and tertiary education and climate change media coverage. And then other variable related to the practical knowledge of climate change. So in terms of appreciation of the damages inflicted by extreme weather episodes, in terms of financial damages, and also in terms of physical distress of exposition to warming temperatures, here measured by the number of cooling degree days. And obviously we are going to control also for deterministic time and country effects. And we do that in a saturation general to specific context. So the econometric transposition of our model is straightforward, as you can see. I already provided details concerning sample size. So the annual observation for EU 27 countries plus the UK from 2009 through 2019. We then move to linearization of this model, which is then easily estimated within a OLS context. Here, obviously, we are also allowing for deterministic time and country effects, which are not here included in the specification, but indeed taken into account with the estimation stage, which is then performed within a general to specific reduction strategy. And as already pointed out, we are implementing our control for deterministic time and country effects within an input saturation analysis. And I believe this is also something new and extremely powerful, and is opening up additional application of input saturation analysis within panel and cross-sectional analysis. And our estimation framework grants consistency and asymptotical normality of our estimate. I will not be able to show you all the estimated regression. You find all details in the paper, and there is a very sizable appendix providing all details. We haven't relied on OLS estimation. We also estimated models using GLS and therefore allowing for stochastic effects. Now, let me show you just one, the results for just one regression. Here is what I will show you is OLS estimates for our key proxy variable. And the positive impact of per capita GDP is confirmed. And you see also some linear effects here, given by this square GDP variable. We find confirmation for the expected potential role of brown leader and green leader. You can see negative impact concerning the time dummy for year 2017. And positive impact for the impulse time dummy for year 2019. And interestingly, it appears that what we interpret in terms of Greta Thunberg effects appear to dominate the Donald Trump effect. Then you find a positive impact on climate change concern coming from secondary education. A positive impact also coming from physical distress associated with warming temperature, and also from appreciation of financial losses generated by extreme weather episodes. Although these interactive terms suggest that these effects tend to decrease as the level of per capita GDP increases. A similar flattening impact on the slope of the climate change awareness curve is played by the level of greenhouse gases emission, while on the other hand, a positive impact, so a steepening effect on the climate change awareness curve is played by social trust. So last comment on the tertiary education. So you see here a negative sign that is for many surprising. And on the other hand, in the paper, we provide a very detailed account of this effect in terms of cognitive bias. And this result is extremely robust across the specification. And our analysis is really robust to any potential misspecification. So there are strong policy conclusions surely following from these results, and we don't want to comment on it right now. So I think it's time for me to move to conclusion. And in particular, I'm going to focus on the policy conclusion. So there are two policy implications that follows from our study. First of all, in light of the key role played by living standard for the positive impact of per capita GDP on climate change attitudes, it appears that income level should be preserved during any transition to a carbon neutral economy. And this is also to preserve support on the side of the public for the implementation of these policies. And this is surely most important in light of the economic recession caused by the COVID pandemic. And secondly, in light of contribution of the media coverage and education to environmental awareness, it surely most important that scientific evidence about climate change be disseminated as broadly as possible to citizens, and this through all possible channels, not just academic one. The role of media diffusion was not pointed out at the time I show you my empirical results, but these results were just related to one specific model. There are several in the paper, and there you find in some specification indeed a positive role given by media coverage of climate change and its effects. And it appears also important to help people to connect climate change to environmental disasters. And in terms of education, we point out to the UK education system as the most advanced one, and a system that could be easily imitated by other countries. Still, as I was suggesting, there is this evidence of an impact, negative impact, coming from tertiary education. And we do trust in these results and our conclusions then that further efforts should be pushed at the tertiary education level. And it appears to be extremely straightforward to include climate change education into academic curricula in social sciences. This is in light of the sizable economic, financial, social, and political consequence of the climate change. And we also point to the importance of broader coverage and better reporting of climate research findings in the mainstream media. So indeed, there is evidence that underreporting of climate findings and other disruptions around the world are a major impediment to information dissemination. And this is also to contrast the contrarian arguments that are often spread through electronic media. And we think that citizens should also be helped to question climate change information campaigns, those that are enacted or sponsored by industries which are highly responsible for greenhouse gas emission and therefore in conflict of interest. And this is also very important to contrast the politicization of climate change. And there is strong evidence for the US that the conservative political leaders contribute to climate change skepticism among their voter. And in the paper, we do find evidence also for Europe. And again, you find this evidence in some of the regressions which are reported in the paper. And let me then conclude with insights on what we are going to work in near future. So we think it's very important to focus on the cognitive component of climate change cognition. And this too, in order to understand what are the driver that move people from cognitive and affective experience of the environmental concern to action to preserve the environment. And I have done.
Yes, thank you, Claudio, for this very insightful data analysis on climate attitudes, which is also highly policy relevant. As we gather our questions to the end of our session, I will suggest we move on to our third presentation, our last presentation. Which is on the role of warm glow in the prevention of climate change by Carolina Gomez Cuenza, maybe I pronounce it right. So please, Carolina, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Let me share my screen. Can you guys can see my screen now? Let's see you again. Can you see my screen now? Yeah, okay.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
Perfect. Okay, hello everybody. My name, as you said, is Carolina Gomez. I am working in the, I'm going to present a work that I am, in which I am working on with Omar. This is still a work in process. Yeah, the role is the role of warm glow in the prevention of the climate change. So let me start with a question. It says, is there a risk of environmental disaster? Yes, we all know, both of this presentation and talking about this, but the main cause of this disaster, or this probability of this disaster, is linked with the evolution of the global energy consumption. We have been seeing that this consumption has been increasing dramatically in the last 30 years. In the following 25 years, it's expected that it's continued to grow at a lower level, at a lower rate, but it's continued to grow. The point is that this demand is linked with a equally dramatic increase in the emissions. And as we continue in this path, what is going to happen is that we are going to consume this total budget, carbon budget that we have before facing an environmental disaster. But there is ways in we can avoid consume this or use up all this budget. We can bend that curve and try to use less emission or no emission at all. But a part of the specific measure that we need to implement, we also need some changes in behavior and preferences to make these changes possible. And we have a very important behavioral theory that is called One Globe, which can we can help us to make these changes happen. One Globe Giving is a theory introduced by Andreoni in 1990, and he basically said that we have some psychological or social objectives that we need to achieve, and for that reason we enjoy giving. There are a practical example of this theory. One of them is the payoff that we receive when we take action that we consider virtuous, say recycling, for instance. There are other actions, for example, when we spend our monetary resources to buy goods that they have a fair trade certification, not only because it's a working condition, but also because they are produced in a sustainable way. There are other examples when people are paying higher prices for energy or power because they know that they are coming from sustainable energy. And finally, this another point, and Omar and I are working in this point as well, and is that is One Globe Giving is present, it also can be a tool to make that the Paris Agreement goal can be achieved, because government can find a way to incentivize people to change their behavior, so they are more willing to do things for the environment. So having said that, this is the outline of my presentation. We have 5 sections more to go. I am going to skip very quickly my literature review, just only to show you where my main reference are. And I'm going to jump very quickly from my model. In this model, we are bringing together 2 theories, economic growth and behavioral theory, which is One Globe. The economic growth is one model developed by Acemoglu and colleagues. We are assuming that the whole world is that the economy works like a whole world. We have only two kinds of goods, that is dirty and clean. And to resemble the reality, we are assuming that dirty sector is more advanced than the clean sector. Talking about the preferences, we are assuming that the household has homothetic preferences. So they receive utility because consumption, but also because the level of the environment. As I said, we have this consumption, but we also have 2 kind of different goods, that is clean and dirty, and we combine each other to have total consumption. And they can be substitute or complement between them. There are some substitution or complementarity between them. I'm going to explain what is the impact of that each case later. And we are modeling the One Globe as a parameter. You can see here, phi. And this household has a budget constraint, so they need to buy this clean and dirty input, but they also need to, they receive income because wages and because there are some profit for innovation. And the relative prices that they are facing depend on their relative consumption, but depend also the level of their One Globe. The quality, the environment, we model follow this rule, and this rule implies that every time that we consume dirty goods, we are degrading the environment, but the environment also have a own rate of regeneration. But the point is that we need to find a way to avoid that the environment get the level equal to 0, because at that point is when we are in an environmental disaster, we also are in a point of no return. And from the production side, we have 2 layers. We have some producer of the dirty and clean goods. These guys use a continuum of machines. There are specific sector machines, and each of these machines has a specific level of technology. There are entrepreneurs that they produce these machines, but when they're in a monopolistic competitive way. When we solve the we maximize the problem of these two guys, we can have demand for intermediate goods that we are going to use later. But this is the expression for each of these machines. And we can also have relative prices in terms of technology. And this is going to be important when I am going to explain you what is the equilibrium condition. And we can also have say that the technology in each sector is an average of the technology in each of these machines. And the process of innovation. In this model, growth occurs because we have innovation. No matter in what sector, but innovation is the engine in this model. So how does the process work? Okay, we have a group of scientists fixed every period. These guys are going to decide in what sector is going to direct his research. Once they are allocated in sector, they are going to be randomly allocated in machines. When they work in the machines, they have a probability to be successful and improve the quality of that machines. If that improvement happens, so the rate in the improving that technology is going to be gamma, which means that we can express the evolution of technology in each of these sectors in this way, in this equation that you can see here. So to summarize this part, what he said is that we have scientists, they innovate. If they innovate, they can produce a better machine and they become entrepreneurs. So, but how they decide in what sector they are going to innovate? Okay, they have a expected return, which is this expression that we have here. And we basically are going to compare in each period, what the profit in each sector is, and they are going to decide to innovate in the sector that has higher profits. This is the most important equation in the model, because here is when we drive innovation. So for instance, therefore we drive growth. We have at here, we have two big possible results, if I can say in that way. We can have corner solution in this, if there is a substitutability between this inputs clean and dirty. Or we can have an interior solution, and we can have a balanced growth path. I'm going to explain this one in a minute. When we said that we have a corner solution, it's because we are assuming at the beginning that the dirty sector in this model, the dirty sector, is more advanced than the clean sector. So every time, when this happened at the beginning, all scientists are going to be in the dirty sector. And because the period, in the next period, that sector was which has higher profit. So in the next period, it's going to happen again. So the process is going to reinforce by itself over time. So unless that we have a way to manage to put this relative profit in favor of clean energy, we are not going to be able to have innovation in clean energy, because every time we are going to innovate in the dirty sector, and the bad result of this one is we are going to end up in an environmental disaster. So the point here is that we need to do something to manage the way that we can have more innovation in a clean sector, and this is what I'm going to explain later. In the other case, if this input are substitute, we can have an interior solution, which means that we are going to have innovation in both sectors. And at the beginning, we are going to have also more innovation in the clean sector, because the dynamic of the model is that we need to take the technology of the less advanced sector to the same level as the other one. So we are going to have this innovation in clean sector for a while. But once this sector has get the equilibrium or get the steady state solution, we are not going to avoid an environmental disaster, because by definition in this economy, but under this condition, we need both input to produce and to grow. What is OneCloud doing here is that they are making that the disaster is going to be delayed over time, because when I increase this one, the equilibrium is going to be, the ratio between the technology are going to be lower. So every time I'm going to need to put more clean technology or more resources in a clean sector to get that level. So in summary, OneCloud helps in this condition, but it's not going to be enough. So as I said, there is only one possibility, and it's when they are substituted and we need to do something. And the way to do something here is try to figure out what is the optimal policy that we can implement. So I'm going to show you how we can solve the model under assuming that we have a central planner solution. And this, the model is exactly the same as, that you, as I showed you. This is the same equation, the same structure. And just to remind you, you know that when we solve a model from the central planner problem, we are saying that there is a guy that is just looking the whole economy and he said, okay, what is the best result that we need? And we are going to allocate the resources to get that result, to the resources to get that result. And in this case, it's to avoid an environmental disaster. So what he finds is that when he compute the relative prices, when he is solving the household problem and he is computing the relative prices, in this case it's relative shadow value, they find that they need to include a new term in this relationship. Is you remember when what I showed you before, we had only have the warm glow parameter. In this case, he has an extra one. And this extra one is a way that he finds to internalize the fact that every time that we are consuming dirty goods, we are degrading the environment, which is something that we didn't do in the decentralized equilibrium. And this is the term that we commonly call a carbon tax. In terms of this, the production side, he didn't make any significant changes. But when he goes to allocate the scientists, he computes the same ratio that I showed you before. There are new extra horrible term here, but basically this term, what it's saying is that the social planner said, we also need to be aware that every time that we innovate, there are future benefits of that innovation. So we need to compute a net value, net present value of that future benefit in both sectors to say what is the best way to allocate scientists. He also knows that this net present value in the clean energy has a social, higher social value because they are not degrading the environment when we are innovating in clean sector. So what that means is that he said, okay, I make all this computation and I said, I need more clean, more sector, more scientists in clean sector. And how can we translate this one in the real world and in economy? In a practical way, how can translate this policy? Saying that we need a tax, a carbon tax, as I show you. And we also need this subsidy, clean R&D subsidy to try to capture these future benefits and to try to change the dynamic that I explained before, that if we don't do anything, all innovation is going to be always in the dirty sector because it's the more advanced from the beginning. What the social planner said is when I use these two tools, I can change the dynamic and push that the innovation is going to clean in it, to clean sector. And the result of that is that we're going to have more space to improve the environment and avoid an environmental disaster. And we are going to show you now some simulation that we have been done for this model. To calibrate the model, we use most of the standard values that this literature use. We are most of them following the Acemoglu work. And to start with the decentralized equilibrium, what we find, and it's basically what we find in the model, is that if they are complementary, we can avoid an environmental disaster. Here, just to be a little precise, when this is the increase of the temperature. So when the increase six is when we are in an environmental disaster. So what the model is showing is that if these two input are complements, we can avoid an environmental disaster, but the one glow is doing the problem less painful because it's delayed it over time, but we are going to have the problem. And in this case it makes sense because as I said, we need if they are complement, we need both inputs to produce and to grow. So there is no way to avoid that. In the sustainability case, the ground glow is doing exactly the same, it's delayed the problem, but we are not going to avoid it anyway. Because as I said, we start with an advance and there is nothing different in the economy. And the warm glow is not higher enough to helping us to to drive the whole innovation to clean energy. So we again are going to face the disaster later, but we are going to face it. In terms of the allocation of scientists, but makes sense with what we just saw, and this most of the scientists are going to be in the beginning in the clean sector, but they are going to reduce, and we are going to have innovation over time in both sectors. In terms of the optimal policy, we saw that, as I show you, because this guy intervened or give us advice that what is the way to intervene the economy, we can avoid an environmental disaster for sure. If they are substitute, we are not going to do it. They are complement by definition, as I just explained. And you can see a little overlap in the graph in the right-hand side. What it's doing is that the one glow is making that everything is going to be sooner. I mean, we are going to avoid and reduce the increasing the temperature sooner, but the difference between the cases is really low. If this is only translate what we just said in terms of how we allocate scientists. And the other good thing here is that in terms of the tools, the carbon tax, what we found is that every time that I have a higher one glow, we can have a lower carbon tax, which means that we are having less distortion in the economy, because we are going to, if we have to pay, we have to pay less taxes. Happened the same with the subsidy. Every time the one glow is helping me to reduce, to don't have to put so much subsidy, they are going to be over time, yes, but it's going to be lower if I have the one glow. And just let me jump with the conclusions. Just the first thing that we said is the problem is not really how much energy we are consuming. The problem is with the kind of energy that we are consuming. We need to be sustainable in the level of the energy that we are consuming. Otherwise, we are not going to solve this problem. The idea to introduce this one glow giving theory in an economic growth is because, as the two previous presentations show, the attitude of the people is changing, and we can use it that like an extra channel to mitigate this problem and not only waiting for some kind of governmental distortion like taxes, subsidies. It's key that we can say that these two inputs are substitute, because otherwise we can avoid the disaster, because we are going to use dirty energy or non-sustainable energy forever. But they are substitute, we can be sure that we can survive only with one kind of energy, in this case, renewable. And the decentralized equilibrium is mean when we are doing nothing, what one glow is helping me is to say, okay, I can delay this problem over time, but not solve it. But at least it's something we can see in that way. And the optimal policy is mean when we just intervene the market, the one glow is reducing the distortion. But as I said from the very beginning, the one glow is a tool. It can help us, but it has a threshold. We need extra things, we need an extra policy. It's not that we are not saying that we are going to avoid the policy. They have an extra tool, but no, it's the only one that we can use. And that's it. Thank you so much, guys.
Yes, thank you, Carolina. Also a very interesting model development and model application. And I want to move on to our discussant now, to Robert Kaufmann. Please, the floor is yours.
Okay, I hope you can hear me. And
yes.
Let's see, share screen. And where is my PowerPoint? And people see the PowerPoint?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So what I want to say, let me start my clock here. Hang on just a second. Here we go. I want to say, boy, I was really impressed by these papers, in that once upon a time, as you can tell from my gray hairs on my beard, I've been at the fringe of kind of resource economics or environmental economics for a long time. My actual training is in ecology. And I think now, if I were to get my PhD again, I would be much more active in this field, because I think people are really starting to ask interesting questions, important questions. So let me try and illustrate that. So when I started a long time ago, you know, resource or environmental economics really viewed climate change the following way. There was economic activity that emitted gases into the atmosphere that changed climate, had an effect on weather. And then there was this very narrow arrow by which climate and weather would feed back upon economic activity. Think about things like crop yields and alike. And then people would run their macroeconomic models and they would decide, oh, we need a carbon tax or we need tradable permits. And that was it. You know, that was the rest. The rest, the most important parts were really left out of what economists were looking at. But I think the authors of the three papers here have really kind of shown us the way in which economics, environmental economics, can expand its scope and, much more importantly, expand its influence. So let me try and illustrate that. So we just finished the paper by Claudia with this warm glow idea, that this idea that climate and weather can actually influence economic decision-making. And that was a really neat idea about putting it into what, at least to my view, a fairly standard model otherwise. So I really appreciated that. Then we had the paper about climate awareness by Claudio, where all of a sudden now climate policy was influenced by the weather. It wasn't just economic activity, but it was the policy as well that was influencing things. But then we have the third paper that has a whole new box to the paper. So Michael's paper added the idea of politics and this idea that could climate policy actually be costly to politicians? And I found that really interesting as well. And then there are a few more arrows from my outsider perspective that maybe people want to think about, and I'll discuss them in respect to some of the papers in a minute, but maybe climate and weather actually influences politics as well. That is, right now in Texas, or not right now, well, again in Texas, this winter we had in Texas a really severe winter storm that caused problems for the grid. And now this summer, there's a large heat dome over that part of the US that again may cause problems for the grid. So maybe climate and weather actually influences politics. But then there's another interesting question, and that is, does politics influence the kind of climate policy that people choose? And that is, you know, once upon a time, it was what's the most efficient policy, highest cost to benefit or lowest cost to benefit ratio? Let's just do that. Well, maybe not. Maybe the politics influences policy, not such that we're only focused on the most efficient policies, but just what politics can endure and tolerate. So let me kind of go through the three papers and kind of talk about what I thought was really important, and I've already done some of that, but also in my old man way, kind of trying to pay it forward, maybe make some suggestions about ways forward for all three very interesting areas of research. So as Claudia explained, as Carolina explained, you know, this paper was really about how climate influences, in her case, the allocation of scientists and R&D. And she used this idea of willingness to pay for clean electricity. But I would argue that maybe something she wants to think about, including in her model, are social norms. So I look at renewable energies or one area of my research is renewable energies. And one of the things that really struck me as I did the background reading for my most recent research is how much people pay attention to what their neighbors do. So if you're on a Twitter, if you're on a Facebook group, or you follow people on Twitter and they say, boy, I just bought this electric vehicle and it's great, people will buy that electric vehicle even disregarding economic variables. So this whole social norm goes well beyond that. And in my research, what I found was if you put rooftop solar on your house, then your neighbors will put rooftop solar on their house. And if I buy an electric car, my neighbors will buy an electric car. But even more importantly, if I put rooftop solar on my house, my neighbors are more likely to buy an electric car. And if I buy an electric car, my neighbors are going to put rooftop solar on their house. So people view this kind of warm glow in a much more expansive way than perhaps just the allocation of scientists and, you know, the willingness to pay for certain technologies. Then we come to Claudio's paper, and I thought it was really interesting. Again, this whole idea about policy and belief not being us scientists tell you to, like, climate change is real, and you go, okay, we got it, we believe it. This whole idea that people aren't necessarily listening to scientists, and that economic, demographic, things like social trust influence whether people actually believe climate change is a problem. But the interesting thing here is, again, something that I've written on in the past in a paper in PNAS, is how should we measure direct experience? So in his paper, that he had measures of weather influencing whether people were concerned about climate change. And in my paper, we actually tried to measure climate change, whether climate was changing and whether that influenced people's acceptance that climate change was real and perhaps something should be done about it. But that kind of begs a bigger question. Should we be looking at climate? Should we be looking at weather? Or should we be looking at the whole host of irrational reasons in which people do or do not believe in climate change? So the classic example, so with regard to weather or climate, at some point, climate change is different than weather change. And people, if you're a climate scientist, you would argue that people shouldn't pay any attention to weather because that's not telling you anything about whether climate is changing or not. But perhaps that's too narrow. That is, maybe weather is important. And the direct experience of weather. So one of the things that would be interesting to me is, do the people in Texas now believe in climate change any more than they used to now that their electricity went out in the summer, in the winter, and maybe now it's about to go out again in the summer? In other words, when we experience climate-related changes in more than, boy, I should wear a t-shirt today, maybe that has an influence. And we kind of have to be careful with this whole idea of framing and how do we measure direct experience, because there are also studies that find that indoor air temperature, so if I ask you about climate change and I sit you in a warm room, you're more likely to believe in climate change than if I sit you in a nice air-conditioned room or a cool room. And so, boy, it's a very hard question to answer in terms of what measures do we include when we think about whether people do or do not believe in climate change, and what is the role of direct experience. Then we have Michael's paper, Are Climate Policies Politically Costly? And again, I think this is really neat because now not even politics is immune from econometrics and the reach of economists. And we had, you know, so as Michael described, you have measures of climate stringency and economic conditions and market forces and direct experience. And one of the interesting things he pointed out is when fuel prices are low, that maybe that's the time to implement climate change policies. And that's certainly a possibility, which makes me wonder, did we miss a pandemic window to implement a lot of these changes? That is, everybody was shut in, energy prices were really low. Was that the time to kind of, and people were losing their job, not that I was happy about that, but people were losing their job. People are now searching for jobs. Is this a time to try and get that shift among sectors and objects of consumption? And then the other part, Michael, that really interests me is, can we endogenize policy? Is there kind of the equivalent of a logit model that says, these are the factors that say yes or no, a country or a state or a county or something is going to implement a policy? And then can you further talk about a logit model or some type of analysis that says, these are the kind of political systems or leaders or parties that are going to choose carbon taxes as opposed to tradable permits, or as you pointed out, just efficiency standards that kind of fly in under the radar. So let me stop there. I hope I've done my job as a discussant. And again, let me commend everybody, the three authors and their co-authors for these papers, and for Ina for hopefully running, keeping me on time and running the whole show. So thank you, and let me stop there.
Thank you, Robert, for this very intelligent and interesting synopsis of our three paper presentations. And although our time is almost running out, I want to give the floor to the audience to pose some questions, either directly in person or just put some questions in the chat, please. For the moment, I don't see any question. Do we have some hands raised? So I don't see any. But well, if not, then I conclude our session, and I want to give my opinion that I'm also very impressed by these three papers, and also by the comment of Robert. And I think one of the takeaway for me personally is that we can consider like education or the quality of media communicating climate change to the people, and of course, economic and social trust, like social equity policies. We could consider this as implicit climate policies. And that is my personal takeaway. And if there is no other comment, so I will close, and I thank the presenters, and I thank the discussant and the audience for this very insightful presentations. And yes, thanks. Have a nice evening, and see you tomorrow.